right, our next speaker is Kent Bohls. If you haven't met Kent, you know his family. I promise you do. He is a sixth-generation Texan. His great-great-grandfather, William Bohls, married Catherine Pfluger in 1852, bringing the Pfluger and Bohls families together. And that is where Pflugerville came from. Kent has served as the president of the Pfluger Family Reunion and editor of the 2010 Pfluger Family History and the Pfluger Family Cookbook. I'm saying Pfluger a lot. And for the past 10 years, he has been the administrator of the Pfluger Family Facebook page, and he's going to talk to you a little bit about that today. Please welcome Kent.
Well, good morning still. It's a pleasure to be here, and what I have to share is different from everything that you've been a part of so far. It was kind of neat for me to come in here and see that on these displays over here, there's one for the Bohls family, and next to it is for Pflugerville, and I did not know that was going to be in the room, so that's a nice treat. When I was invited to come, I was in New Mexico at the time, and there's a little town north of Taos called Cuesta, and the day after you invited me to come, on the headline of the newspaper, this is a four-page paper, read, Castillo Amalia reunion brings families back to their roots. So that caught my eye. And then I kept reading and said, the families of these two small villages have many memories of this place. With the uptick in people's interest in their ancestry and heritage and the yearnings for connection, a Facebook group was created. And that was kind of a piece of the story. But I wanted to give just a little background about the Bohlses and the Pflugers. You probably all have heard of Pflugerville, so you know that's part of the story. And some of you read the sports section of the Austin American, and that's my brother Kurt Bohls that's been the columnist there for, gosh, since 73, whatever that adds up to. So those two families came together, and as she said, William Bohls, the Bohls family arrived here in 1844. The Pflugers arrived in 1852, and they arrived like in January, and by August of that year, William Bohls and Catherine Pfluger were pronounced man and wife. So that didn't take long. And one reason it didn't take long is that at that time, the population of this town of Austin was about 650. So, you know, just imagine 650 compared to 100,000 at a UT football game. I mean, that's like microscopic. Austin was bounded by 15th Street on the north and the Colorado River on the south, Water Creek on the east, and Shoal Creek on the west. And that was Austin. And so inside of that was laid out in town lots, you know, streets and blocks. And then outside of that were larger tracts of land, maybe 30 or 40 acres. So if you can imagine, the Bohlses came and they were living about where Rosewood Park is, and then the Pflugers arrived and they lived about where the old Miller Airport is. So that was not too far apart, and there was not many people between those two at that time. So after Henry Pfluger got here, he did a land swap with his brother-in-law, who had received 960 acres as a bounty grant for fighting in the War for Independence. And then Henry got his 960 acres east of where Pflugerville is now. And, you know, it's so hard to comprehend that these towns didn't exist. I mean, Austin was 650, Pflugerville was zero, and they lived 2 miles east of zero. And then the Bohlses moved to that area from Bastrop in 1854, so they were once again very close together. And Henry Pfluger came from Germany, Alten Hotzigen, and he had six children, and then his wife died, and then he remarried and had six more children, and so there were 12 kids in that family, and then those 12 kids gave birth to 91 children, and so you get some idea of the multiplier effect that happened. And William and Catherine, for example, had 11 children of their own, and one of them died as an infant. And the Bohlses and Pflugers were both very much church people in Germany. They weren't close together. They were a couple hundred miles apart, but the church was the center of their life. And so in terms of genealogy, We've got baptismal confirmation records that go back several hundred years. So that's a good source of real life information to deal with. So when they got to Pflugerville, and there's no Pflugerville, they got to the area, and church was important, so they would go either to New Braunfels or to Brenham to baptize their babies or to confirm their young people. That would be about seventh or eighth grade. And in 1874, William and Catherine Bohls donated 4 acres of land to create a church. And they did the groundbreaking on the church. I don't know if it was chosen that way, but it was on April Fool's Day that they broke ground for the church. And 81 days later, they dedicated the church. So they, and the church was not like a huge brick building, you know, like Notre Dame that took centuries to build. The church was 26 feet by 44 feet. And today we're accustomed to giving, at least in the church that I grew up in, free will offering. They pass the offering plate on Sunday and you put in what was appropriate. And in those early days in Pflugerville, in what would become Pflugerville, they had dues. And so a farmer who owned land paid $16 a year. A renter with a family on a farm paid $8 a year. And if you were a single person without a family and lived on a farm, you paid $4 a year. Now, the fascinating thing to me about that is that means that everybody had to be a farmer. You know, otherwise you were left out. So that says something about, you know, that little community that was going to work up there. I'm going to fast forward. In 1932, two cousins got together and they drew up a family tree. And the family tree, you know, it was drawn like a tree, had 868 stars on the tree. And those were the number of ancestors of Henry Pfluger Sr. And that little frame piece is on display at the Heritage House Museum in Pflugerville, if you happen to be over in that part of the world. Not too long after that, Charlie Pfluger, who was the last surviving child of Henry Pfluger Sr., and he was living out in West Texas, said, "I think we ought to have a family reunion." And there were enough people that said, "Yeah, that's a good idea." Because by that time, just about everybody that lived right around Pflugerville, so it wasn't a big deal to get together. And so the descendants got together on July 12, 1934. Out of 742 living relatives, 432 of them showed up for the reunion, which is kind of an interesting thing. And at that time, they gathered outside on one of the farm properties along a creek, and they had games and playing, and the men stayed up all night and cooked barbecue. And they had a worship service that was an important part of all of their time together. And on that day, they decided, next year, let's have a family reunion. And so that that continued, and the family reunion has been going on every year since 1934, except for 1 year. And on that year, in 1945, the United States War Committee on Conventions wrote a letter to the Pfluger reunion, and it said, and I've got a copy of it, "Such a reunion falls in the category of a group meeting, and in the opinion of the committee, it should be deferred until a later time when the present restrictions are relaxed or removed. The committee is much interested in the conservation of gasoline." And so the committee voted to not have a reunion in 1945. So, you know, whenever we figure out this is the 100th, it's like, well, do we have to, the minus one? And so that's a little bit tricky. In 1958, some of you that have been around remember a Houston Post columnist named Leon Hale. And he was a columnist for the paper in Houston. And he wrote, "It is a reasonable bet here that Pflugerville is the kinfolkiest town in Texas. The Pfluger reunion, now one of the most famous family reunions in Texas, is still held every July 4th at Pflugerville. And at one time or another, Pflugers have come from all but a few states in the Union. The Pfluger story is the darndest show of family pride I have ever run into. The family has an enviable reputation." So that's, it's kind of nice when you read somebody from the outside, the family, that's saying something nice about you. The family, as I said, was very close. My father was born in Pflugerville, and as he was growing up, he had 32 first cousins, and all but one of them lived in Pflugerville or within 20 miles of Pflugerville. And that one that was away is kind of one of the matriarchs of our family, and Julia celebrated her 103rd birthday in September of this year, and is a key part. So with life together, the question kind of that came, I think, was about how do you communicate with the family? And at one time, the church really was the center point of life in that area. And people would go to church every Sunday. I was with a couple of family members yesterday, and they said that in their memories of kids growing up in the 50s and 60s, that every Sunday they got together at grandma's house. And I said, excuse me, do you mean every Sunday or late for baptisms or celebrate? And they said, no, every Sunday we got together, had a potluck at grandma's house. And I said, well, then after you ate, did you go do your own thing? He said, oh, no, you know, we played dominoes and, you know, football and baseball and hide and seek until 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. So that is a window into that life, that it was so knit together that they all knew each other and everything was centered in their life around the church, which was a special piece of that. Now, a couple of local traditions they had for communicating is that when someone died, you know, this is no telephone or any of that kind of stuff, that the church bell would toll, and the person pulling the bell will ring the bell, the number of years that the person who died. So if you're 81, you get 81 rings. And so what I'm told is that people would kind of sit there and it's like, okay, 1, 2, you know, and count. And then they would try to figure out, you know, it's like, oh, that's probably Uncle Henry or, you know, whoever it might be. So it was kind of an early way of communicating before the internet and all this other kind of stuff. Another tradition was that when there was a wedding, that somebody from the family would handwrite the invitations to the wedding. And then they would be given to a member of the family, and he would ride horseback, and he would go from house to house or farm to farm, delivering the handwritten invitations. Now, what was a little bit different is that in each of the houses that they went to, somebody would say, oh, thank you for the invitation. We're going to come, and they would pin a ribbon to the horseback rider that delivered it. And they would keep long strips of, you know, it wasn't a little, you know, lapel thing, but a long strip of ribbon. And then the rider would go to the next house and the next house. And they said when he came back home, it was like a flying colored bird as he came galloping into the yard. And then the next piece of that is that when the bride and groom actually got married and they came in a carriage or a surrey or whatever, that all those ribbons were hanging from the surrey to kind of bring that whole thing together. In 1911, the first telephone was installed in Pflugerville, and this changed totally the ability to communicate. And, you know, it wasn't a solitary line, so you had a party line, so you were communicating beyond maybe what you intended to communicate. And then in every family, it seemed that there were one or two that were kind of the matriarch or the one that would, you know, get the information for genealogy or history or to be sure that they came to the reunion. In 1910, Pflugerville had 400 people. In 1980, it had boomed all the way to 745. In 2017, they passed 63,000. You know, and so, you know, all of those little family connections that were close together were starting to change. In 1934, at that first reunion, they published a little book of the genealogy of the family, and it was 18 pages long. And we've had several editions since then. In 1949, it went to 66 pages, 61, 74 pages, 69, 89 pages. But you get the idea. In 2010, we put together a history book that was 430 pages long. And of that 430 pages, 270 were for genealogy, and then the rest was a gathered history that we were able to put together and bring together. When I was growing up, once a year, we would get a postcard in the mail, and the postcard on the back, we knew it was going to say, but it said, Pfluger Reunion in Pfluger Grove in Pflugerville will be on July 4th. Bring a side dish or a dessert. Everyone knew what was going to happen. In 2009 and 2010, I was the president of the Pfluger Reunion, and you think, a president, you know, but we had a full set of committees, and it takes a little coordination to pull all that kind of stuff together. And we were coming to the reality of that we were so spread out that many of these people had never lived in Pflugerville and weren't even close around. And we had to find new ways to communicate. And we're updating the 2010 book next summer. And right now we have over 6,000 members of the family. So when you were talking about how many are, you know, this is in that Pfluger family. The mailing of postcards has gotten to be a quaint piece of the past. You know, one is how do you find addresses for people that are moving, you know, every 3 years? And then how do you afford to put the stamps on all those things too? So that became more difficult. We started gathering email addresses, and this was fairly recently. And I think right now we've got 495 email addresses in our database. And we've moved to, this last year we used Evite, you know, which feels like a giant leap from postcards, to have people confirm if they're coming to the family reunion. And in my parents' generation, you know, they knew everybody. But, you know, that generation, I mean, you know, when you were saying, you know, ask your mother or your grandfather, and I realized, you know, I'm the oldest in my generation now. So that's a different kind of thing. And so one of the things we're trying to do with this family is not just to know the facts, but to have a sense of what it means to be connected. And in 2009, we came out with a Pfluger family cookbook. And, you know, you've seen these at schools and different fundraising projects. But, you know, a family reunion is a great way because on every recipe, we've got the name of who the recipe came from. And then frequently we had a little something about that person. And so there's a lot of memory. I was looking through it last night, and, you know, it was just like it brought back different things. And, you know, you sense how times have changed. And, you know, we don't use Crisco all the time now. You know, it's a little bit different deal. But, you know, I saw that there were three recipes for sweet rice. And if you're not German and don't know that, that's like, you know, what's that? But there were, five recipes for potato salad, three for chili, and seven recipes in the book for honey cookies. And, you know, we vetted that, and each one had a little bit tweak difference. But we also had recipes for possum, tongue, edible Play-Doh, organic mosquito repellent, homemade soap, glass cleaner, and homemade cough syrup. But, you know, going through that and seeing the names, you know, brings back memories, and those connections become alive in a little bit different kind of way. In 2009, we did what those little communities in northern New Mexico did. We started a Facebook group. And, you know, I know that Facebook, you know, everybody knows what Mark Zuckerberg looks like because of his hearings on Capitol Hill. So, you know, we can talk about, I choose not to talk about the problems of Facebook, but look at what we've done. When we started Facebook, I started it and I was the only person. So, you know, started as one. I see Jane's back here, so I know there's one more Facebook family member in the room. But this week, we now have 500 members of the family that are on Facebook. And what that enables us to do is to share information back and forth. Our Facebook group has been a place to post pictures, to share news of babies born, deaths, obituaries, weddings, anniversary, and occasionally a bit of humor, if we can slide that in. This last year at the reunion, that was on July 4th, you'll know that now, right? I took just random pictures of people at the reunion, and so for 2 months, every day I would post two or three pictures from the reunion, and you know, people that were there, you know, they're going to remember that, but people that weren't will have a sense of being connected to it as well. A short time ago, I found, has anybody ever heard of the Defender in Travis County? Okay, got a couple of folks. I came across the 1936 Defender, and that's the yearbook of all of the rural schools in Travis County. And so I took pictures of every page of the Pflugerville schools, and so I've been posting a couple of those pictures every day for a while. So, you know, it's another little discovery. It's a place that we request updates for genealogy. Like, you know, sometimes people will say, I've got a new baby, and then I'll tag Shelley because Shelley's our genealogist keeping the records, and then she'll snag that record and add it to the chart for the book. People find family heirlooms. I had somebody that contacted me and said, you know, this was grandmother's photo album. We don't know who these people are, but can you use it? And I said, please, you know, let me get my hands on it. And so I posted pictures out of that photo album for a lengthy time and just invited people to tell us who they are. And that was a way to gather and increase and archive some of that that information. Julia was 103. Like I said, I put a picture on Facebook, and just the stream of congratulations to her, you know, became a beautiful thing, and to be able to share that with her. To be able to host that and have it meaningful, that I try to post a minimum of 5 times a week. And from what I've seen about Facebook information, if you don't do it regularly, it's not going to show up in your feed or be able to see it. So occasionally some of the groups around, and you may have some other ideas for me, but occasionally I'll repost from the German Texas Heritage Society. I know they're out here. Native Texas, Austin as it used to be. I grew up in Taylor, so I say remember Taylor, Texas. Pflugerville Small Business, Austin, Texas History, and Central Texas History. So the goal that we have is to try to keep this heritage alive and keep people connected to one another. And I've gone to several seminars on Facebook, but they said the best thing that you can do on Facebook, if you believe in something you're looking at, if you don't believe, you know, that's fine. If you believe in it, the best thing you can do is to share it. And just hit share and have it go to your own page. Or maybe you've got a friend and say, I want that friend to see that, so I'll share it to your page, you know, and we'll pass that on. The second best thing that you can do is to write something. Say, great, wonderful. Or to put an emoji. And, you know, my grandkids have been real glad to help me know what an emoji is and put that on there. And then the next best thing you can do is like it. And, you know, sometimes we don't get many responses, but then I hear from all sorts of people about, you know, they really enjoyed, you know, seeing this on Facebook. So, you know, they're kind of stealthily watching what's there, but they're not participating in it. And that's okay, too. I understand that. I haven't taken anything down, but, you know, we don't encourage political type stuff. We don't want any fake news or put downs of people. And we really, you know, we vet everybody. You've got to ask to be part of it. You can see it without asking, but to be a part of it. And we look one first to see if they're in. We say, are you in the book? Because we've been doing these books for years. You know, are you connected or related or somebody that would get you in? So I realize it's kind of like a needle in a haystack now to what's the best way to communicate with people. And this keeps changing every day. And I think that, you know, we've seen it go from, you know, tolling a bell to putting ribbons on a horseback rider to telephone to email, postcards in between. And now we've got Evite and Instagram and WhatsApp and Snapchat and texting. And I know I'm part of a Rotary Club group. And, you know, the question is, how do you communicate with your group? And it's like, well, I only look at text. I don't look at that. And, you know, somebody else wants it in email. And so finding that out is a tricky way to connect one another. And I think that reunion groups and churches and political groups, volunteer associations, they're all looking for ways to connect, and we keep searching for a way to do that. Several years ago, we decided that it was too much work for the guys to spend all night doing barbecue to get ready for the reunion. And so we started catering our meals and having like Pokey Joe's to come in. And we just still have the family members bring desserts because we're not giving up desserts. You know, that's not going to happen. But about 20 years ago, you know, like everything else, the cost kept going up. And the meal cost, and we started getting a little nervous because at what point are we going to say, I'd really like to go to the reunion, but it's too expensive for me to come with my family. And so my youngest brother lives in Houston, and he's got a business called Awareness Design, and he does custom designing and printing of T-shirts and caps and coffee mugs, you know, just a whole variety of things like that. And so we created about 20 years ago a Flugger pop-up store. It's only open on one day a year, and it's at the reunion. And he designs a new shirt every year, sometimes two designs. And we've got the shirts out there, the family history book. We still have cookbooks left. I should have brought some today to give you a chance at cookbooks. And we have a chance to sell this, which is helping us on our budget for the meals. But I guess the biggest thing we found is that it helps us with the pride of family and the sense of having an identity. If I can get behind the podium and see my shirt, that, you know, proud to be a Flugger. And this summer I was in New Mexico and I had my new Flugger ball cap. And in three different towns, I had people stop and make a comment. On the front of the cap, it had the letters PF, nothing else. But there were enough people that somehow identified with Fluggerville and Flugger family that we were able to pass that identity on. We realize that people are more and more spread out all the time. People are busy with their daily schedule, and sometimes getting around to doing genealogy or family history is something, I'll get to that later, maybe when I retire. But somewhere down the line, somebody's going to ask, where'd your family come from? Do you know what your ancestry looks like? Or maybe, you know, you've seen so many of these ads for these DNA kits that you finally say, I'm going to do it. I'm going to check it out. And then you might start your search from ground zero. But I would venture to guess that those people who are part of the Flugger family would start rattling an answer to that that would be more than you wanted to hear. Social media has given our family a special link for many folks, and that my hope is that for the generations to come that aren't connected physically with Flugerville, that they will be connected on a bigger scale to their ancestry and to their heritage, and that will mean something to them. And I hope that you too will discover what works for your family along the way. So thank you for the chance to be here.